We move to the next presentation. Dr. Shilpa Ashok Panditji, she's an associate professor in the Chinmaya University. Dr. Shilpa ji will be speaking on Bhavana, tracing transformation of consciousness in the Bhakti traditions of Hinduism. Dr. Shilpa ji.
I'm very happy indeed. Very pleased that and thankful that I was given this opportunity to present. So the title of my presentation is Bhavana, Tracing Transformation of Consciousness in Bhakti, Traditions of Hinduism. And I have chosen this very carefully because I have been working in the academics for some time, as well as I have been practicing through the Guru Parampara. And I have found this disconnect with which Vinay wonderfully mentioned and which Nagaraji has been alluding to. So what happens is that bhakti traditions not only get distributed into the historical or the anthropological aspects of as a person who has traveled in both the worlds, I understand the problems of translation, not of words, but of thoughts. Literally, the thoughts that are represented are regressed, are sophisticated, are sukshma, but are meant or indicated by the words. As Jayaraman has written in one of his books, chapters on samadhi and other things that he has written, the Shabda Sanketa is very important, which needs to be understood. So one of the things in psychology has also struggled a lot. And as Vinay and Anu have mentioned, we are seeing a lot of additional aspects entering into psychology through contemplation and reflective practices, as well as through what is broadly called as the mindfulness tradition now. So what is this Euro-American legacy, which is very important to understand when we use the word spirit, spirituality, etc., etc. The legacy of Euro-American legacy is a fragmented psyche. Just so the contemporary psychology inherits a dualism, which has been very famously called as the mind-body dualism. And we have a serious problem till about 30 years back, when due to the increased exchange between the East and the West, research started improving and incorporating aspects of these binaries. But the point about binaries is deeper than that. It's about logic and the either-or binaries in philosophy itself. And we will find that the logical systems of Nyaya as well as Jaina logic are much more broader and accommodating to understand how humans reason and understand something logically. But this particular binary, one is the mind-body dualism, then the binary between reason and affect, very important for me to develop my argument further, and this no self trisection between cognition, affect, and behavior. So what happens is, if you do research studies where you use survey methods, you're focusing on behavior alone. If you're doing cognition, you're stuck with the mental abstractions alone. And what happens to affect? Affect was always a problem for psychologists, a serious problem for psychologists. And that's why the morning presentation by Acharya Sharma was central, because it identified this concept of sadhana, because there is a trisection and binarization of thoughts. What happens is you get topographically flat models. So no transformation of consciousness is possible. You also have a problem of transcendental and embodied as opposites to each other. So the idea of Jivan Mukti is difficult, because Jivan Mukti is living while being free, which means you're alluding to a binary as if you cannot be free while being in body. So there are several minute, profound problems in the way it is logically framed. And then what happens is you cannot connect in psychology the way it exists in conventional mainstream several states of mind towards well-being. So the directionality is missing, which we find now, which I will try to put forth. Then, of course, there's a deeper philosophical issue, which is also an applied psychology issue of mind versus consciousness, which says that consciousness emerges. Now, of course, in the next 5-10 years, I'm seeing that it's going to go away. It's not going to hold. That argument is going to fall flat, precisely because it is an untenable argument, because it's not an applied psychology argument. Added to that, we have these popular psychology problems that and use of English language, which completely destroys the context. So it's not, I mean, we must honor the tradition, yes, but unless we don't know the context which the tradition provides, we are going to distort because we have no idea what we are talking about. So when we translate words into English, we are walking into a completely new terrain. And in fact, I feel that we need to continuously use the original words in that original context, because the context is coded, as we call it in Sanskrit, pravritti nimitta. So what problems can happen? The problems that happen are about this, you know, general casual use of the word positive and negative emotion, then the idea of self, no self, and the idea of social self, embodied self, a whole lot of terminologies which confound and destroy the clarity that is required to create a model for transformation, which is sadhana. And that is the kind of a difficulty that we are facing in psychology currently, which is the reason why we are moving towards mindfulness. Why should we move towards mindfulness otherwise? So philosophically, in comparative philosophy, some good philosophers of the Indian philosophical tradition have talked about and tried to translate in the very nuanced way. So one of the ways in which Ram Prasad, a philosopher in UK, is an Advaitin, has used the term ownerless consciousness. And I particularly appreciate the use of this word, because the word owner includes jnata, karta, and bhokta. And so the ownerless consciousness is what he has been writing a lot. We can see it on the internet or write to him. Then another term that has been used now is called as non-representational reflexivity. And so if we want to translate something in English, because we have that IKEA, as Anu said, so we have to translate very carefully about what we exactly mean, because the pravritti nimitta for the Indian terms are so sukshma that if we make a mistake, then we have made profound mistakes in our understanding of everything. The recent neuroscience researchers are talking about new words that are being coined. Enactivism is coined to do this binary between action and thinking. So in order to address this binary between action and thinking, or mind-body dualism, the word enactivism is being used now, or the term embodied cognition, which is a direct way to solve this mind-body dualism that plagues the continental philosophical traditions. So I want to answer this question specifically in relation to Manasa Puja. We look at Manasa Puja as a beginning step. Actually, it is the beginning and the end as well. Because ultimately, in cases of Jivan Mukti or Krama Mukti, what we are talking about is a completely innovative, radical psychology that came in the Indian context, which talks of being free while being alive. So, which removes all these binaries through these practices, which are lived experiences, as Dr. Durai Swami said in her presentation. Now, in this whole thing, what is the big sukshma problem? The sukshma problem is the role of affective processes is a big problem for the continental philosophical traditions, the continental philosophical traditions have a big problem about dilemma, horns of a dilemma, which is a binary Greek logic, and affect as an opposite to reason. Whereas the whole mindfulness says that you can be mindful about affect. It has broken that binary, or it has made that attempt that can you be mindless? Is affect always mindless? No. So we can break that and we can be mindful about affect. Now, be that as it may, one of the problems that happens is that we become intellectual monsters. And I don't mean intellect. I mean intellect in the sense of Shabda Panditya, you know. We become intellectual monsters. We understand all the words. We understand all the concepts. But there is no transformation that has happened in us. So this is my answer to Vinay. And all, of course, Vinay knows about it. This is the reason why academicians are not able to understand or process or to say what is happening. And so what is the use of focus as a cognitive strategy? If the object of your focus and the emotion with which you relate is not purified. So the idea of Chitta Shuddhi, as Nritya wonderfully presented, is completely associated with bhava and bhakti. And I will try to show that very briefly in this whatever time that I have. So because there is a problem about rationality and logic in the continental traditions, there is more focus on the cognitive processes. And those cognitive processes are further behavioralized in the positivistic research method. So it's a reduction of a reduction of a reduction, which becomes such a dumb process that the whole nature of sadhana is lost. Even though there are more than 300 studies, which Vinay mentioned about whether yoga works or not, yoga literally works in the most reduced forms as shown in statistically significant differences. So really it doesn't capture the possibilities of that innovative, radical, profound psychology that this tradition has given. Now, which is where we are talking about the self. And Ganeri, who is one of the professors in philosophy, a very good philosopher, but he's a logician. So he has argued in his latest book, No Self. So it doesn't. We don't need a self. He's a naturalist by inclination. And we can do away with self, but he says attention is required. Now, I don't agree with him, which I have written separately. But we need IKEA of the self system for higher levels of symbolization, abstraction, for inner objects as well as for external objects. Internal objects are all your internal objects, positive emotion, negative emotion, even the objects, the presence of internal presence of your mother or your father or your guru, etc., etc., etc. So in the Indian tradition, in the Indic traditions, we actually see an integration of yoga, Advaita, Sri Vidya, Trika, Shaiva, which I have been saying for quite some time, because this was what taught to me by the oral tradition of the Guru Parampara. So yoga starts as Periyavar, as Nritya has said about Periyavar's poems that he has written, and then moves to Advaita, and then in the non-dual Trika Shaiva tradition, which finds its influence in the Pancharatra Agamas, Vaishnava Agamas, as well as in the Shaiva Siddhanta, as well as in the Sri Vidya texts. So there is an integration that has happened in the historical time. You can find it. Now, my question particularly here is to focus on the word bhava or bhavana, because that is the central word which you find across all traditions. So my questions are, what are the models of transformation, effective models of transformation, effective transformation available in Indian psychology? What are the conceptual frameworks? Because I'm an academician, so I must find the Shabda Pramana, the Shabda Sanketa, and I must do it with a great sense of respect for the adversary, my intellectual adversary as well. And I would say, and I have said it in one of my earlier writings, that bhakti is that dhyana moment of Indian modernity, because it incorporates all the Indic values of love, oneness, from Advaita, as well as fellowship. And you can see it in the writings of Vallabhacharya or the Gaudiya Vaishnava Parampara of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu or the Bhakti Parampara in the Dravidi Bhakti, which is the definition of bhakti itself is Dravidi Bhakti from the holy land of Dravidas. So you see this confluence of the bhakti traditions from north, south, east and west, where they aligned the values of bhakti, love, oneness, fellowship, whether it's the Chidvilas of the Natha Sampradaya and the Jnaneshwari that is going to be discussed, or in the northern Suradasa bhakti tradition, or in, as I said, in the Gaudiya and the Dravidi bhakti. So my answer to that earlier question on Buddhism and Yoga Sutra comparison is this, to my intellectual disagreement with Dr. Jayaprakash, existence is not dukkha at all. It is the early Buddhists, the Pali Theravadas, who say that existence is dukkha. Existence is Leela, Satchidananda's Leela. There is no dukkha. Dukkha is in the Jiva Bhava. And there comes the word Bhava. And so I want you to hold on to this word. There is no dukkha in the existence as such. If you hold the Jiva Bhava, then there is dukkha. And that abstraction is not found in the Pali Theravada traditions, definitely. It is found in the Mahayana traditions, and Mahayana traditions have been then discussed, and people have had intellectual scandals that they turned Advaitin, by the way. So now I'm going to come to the Pravritti Nimitta. This I will run through fast because this is an enlightened audience. You know more about this than me. Several keywords for consciousness, important for their functional relevance. Why this important? Because when you want to translate, you should be very careful. Otherwise, don't translate. What are the different words? Chit, Nija, Vastu, Atman, Jivatman, Paramatman, Ishvara. Several central concepts. And I wouldn't dare to translate them because I'm not a Sanskrit scholar. Now, one of the key binaries that I have been focusing is consciousness as transcendental, therefore disembodied. What is that? What kind of a binary is that? This is not a lived reality at all. And this is not an applied psychology of India. Now, the word manas is found across all texts. We don't have time. This is an enlightened audience. You can do an etymological analysis or textual analysis of it. I have seen it in the 10th richa of the 10th mandala of the Rigveda in the sense of manyate. And so in Sankhya, particularly, it is used as a sensory motor coordinating mechanism. Now, manas embodies. This is how we could see that. Because it is sensory motor coordination, it embodies. Chitta shows continuity of self from past, present, and future. And ahamkara individuates consciousness in this antahkarana that has been talked a lot in several of the texts, especially Vedantic texts of Advaita, as well as Vishishta Advaita. Is a pervasive word concept, a framework to understand antahkarana, as the earlier Acharya has also said. Now, where is affect in this? Some question might be asked. Affect is in the very swarupa, which is Satchidananda. So why this focus on cognition? You find out the answers for it, too long for me to discuss, but affect is central to the transformation of ahamkara. So the moment affective transformation takes place, the transformation of ahamkara or the idea of self takes place, as one of the persons has said in the morning, I think it was Dr. Arya. So what happens in the transformation of ahamkara? The transformation of ahamkara from a vyavaharika ahamkara to shuddha ahambhava. And you can see this in Pratiprasava as well. And as Krishnamacharya Periyavar would say, you would see that this asmita is different than the vyavaharika asmita, as Raghu would also say that. Now, so the point here is this, that you are getting a spiral model of transformation of consciousness, which is based on your transformation of your affect. And what is that affect? Affect is, who am I? How am I relating to the world? So if I am the body and I have to relate to the world, then I have to have fear in me. And therefore, the world will be in dukkha or in fear. Why not? It will be. Can we transform that? Yes, there are models, but anyway. So the point here is that we are arriving at a spiral model of transformation of consciousness, which is not what I'm cooking up, even though I, by the grace of the Divine Mother, I can cook. It is the Mother or the Divine, the sacred consciousness, which is doing this. So we start from Koham and we come to Soham, and the central hidden word in this is Bhavanam. Okay, so because Vyasa himself says yoga samadhi, so yes, yoga samadhi, right? Then you Paramartha Sara in Trikashaiva says chittam mantra. Whatever is there in the chitta is mantra. The chitta is always having a mantra in it. What kind of mantra it is having is the question. So why the focus?
Conclude, madam. Thank you.
Yeah. I'm just going to stop in 2 minutes. So why the focus on attention and concentration? Forget about it. I'm going to talk about just one particular model, the Ayurvedic model. I will skip it. I will just focus on, since we are talking about Raja Yoga, a lot of people have talked about Raja Yoga here. I will focus on the concept of Vairagya, particularly because it is very amenable to the discussion on Buddhism, etc. Because the definition of Vairagya in PYS is Drishta Anushravika Vashikara Sangya. That is the Vairagya, right? Now, we have esoterized the concept of Vairagya, but in the definition itself, the sensory modalities are shown, Drishta and Anushravika, which talks about visual and auditory attention. Vashikara means the sense of mastery and regulation, and Sangya means the mind. So we are connecting the body and mind directly here. And the term Bhava and Rasa, and after this I'm stopping. So the word Bhava in Bhakti is defined as an intentional focused state of contemplation and relationality towards a consciously chosen form, name and quality. This definition occurs in the Gaudiya Vaishnava text Bhakti Rasamruta Sindhu in the 5th chapter, Canto 132 and 133, while rasa is defined as an experience of delight, of amazement, which is beyond contemplation. So, bhava is to be cultivated and rasa is sphurat. It happens without planning. Now, with this definition, bhakti is understood as jnanottara bhakti, which means that meditation gives us the jnana or the tattva jnana, but bhakti is prior and post the atmanivedana, right? So in Yoga Sutra, the definition of dhyana is pratyaya ekatanata. And so this jnana which arises from vairagya and viveka in this model of bhakti is in the bridge, middle, whereas life as such is centered around the retransformation of the understanding of self, which is changed by the understanding of the affect. And so one of the other points that we use more than going beyond Shaiva Siddhanta is, can you play a lifelong role like Thakur Sri Ramakrishna played, or several other bhakti saints played? They chose a role and they played that role throughout their life in a reality which they recreated and thereby changed the whole world around them socially as well. So bhavana as an intentional cultivation of bhakti rasa to then embody that consciousness in your social life. So with this, I'm stopping this. Thank you very much. And I'm so sorry. I think because of the changes in the screening, I was not able to manage my time.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you for those profound observations on the transformation and the emphasis on retaining those original expressions in the traditional lore and not translating to reducing the import and the content of the knowledge herein. Thank you very much.